Call to order the meeting of the Environment Committee for Tuesday, December 11th. And the first item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda.
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The agenda has been approved. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes. Were there any changes or corrections?
Move approval.
Okay, we have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
The minutes have been approved. And now we move to the business portion of the meeting, and the first item of business is 2018-346, same week. And this is a reclaimed water agreement with Enerkem, and Deborah Manning is going to walk us through this. Hi, Deborah.
Hi. Good afternoon, Madam Chair and Council members. Thank you for the opportunity to talk with you today. This item is about a reclaimed water service agreement with Enerkem. And as we presented before, this is in regard to reclaimed water service in our proposed Southeast Metro Water Reclamation Facility would be producing that reclaimed water. It would divert about 2 million gallons a day of effluent from the Empire plant at a treatment site at the former Rosemont treatment plant site, treat the effluent to that higher level needed for reuse. It would be then pumped to the proposed Enerkem facility, their waste to biofuels proposed facility in Invergrove Heights, and used for processed water and cooling water. Some key dates as this project has developed, or this relationship with Enerkem has developed. In March of 2017, Enerkem submitted a letter of interest in reclaimed water. In February of this year, the council authorized staff to negotiate a memorandum of understanding and a design deposit agreement with Enerkem. In April, the council authorized a public hearing for the Southeast Metro Water Reclamation Facility plan, which lays out some of the concept for that Southeast Metro facility. And then in May, we had a public hearing on the facility plan. In June, council adopted that facility plan. In July, we submitted it to the MPCA for PFA funding review. In September, the MPCA granted preliminary approval of the facility plan, which again formed the basis for design of the council's facilities. In December, the council meeting tomorrow, we're requesting authorization to execute a memorandum of understanding and preliminary design deposit agreement with Enerkem, and that's the subject of my presentation. The agreements with Enerkem are, there are two, a non-binding memorandum of understanding, which memorializes our joint understandings and expectations of the developing project, and also a design deposit agreement for prelimininary design. And that defines the commitment of and method for Enerkem's payment of preliminary design costs. Key points about the memorandum of understanding: it is non-binding, but it lays out a number of items. It establishes Enerkem's method of payment for council activities, meaning the design, construction, and operation of the Southeast Metro Water Reclamation Facility. It, again, defines the facility plan as the basis for preliminary design. It makes clear that Enerkem's waste to biofuel facility costs are their responsibility, so anything related to that is that facility in Invergrove Heights itself is their responsibility. And then there are key terms for a future reclaimed water service agreement. So the plan here is to have these design deposits for the design phase, and then to have the reclaimed water service agreement in place before construction and operation begins. And the memorandum of understanding outlines our mutual understandings about delivery of reclaimed water, quality, quantity, use, also service availability charge that Entercom would be to pay, industrial waste discharge permitting and fee, service interruption, service fees, Entercom's financial guarantee, permits, insurance, the term, default, and dispute resolution and termination. All of those would be in a future reclaimed water service agreement. The design cost deposit agreement key points include that it is binding. It binds Entercom to pay for the council's preliminary design costs work for, via a deposit. There's a payment schedule tied to the preliminary design work products. The amount would be reduced if the council receives an MPCA grant, and I'll talk more about that in the next business item shortly. The maximum preliminary design cost would be $600,000, and the potential MPCA reuse grant of $300,000 could be applied to that design cost. Coordination of work, a lot of coordination would be needed between us and Entercom, would be via a technical coordination team comprised of Entercom and Council key project staff. I mentioned the MPCA reuse grant. We've been discussing the possibility of receiving a wastewater reuse grant. That's in conformance with the council's policy that we will pursue non-council funds for wastewater reuse projects. And we've been discussing receiving a $300,000 reuse grant, which was authorized by the legislature in 2017. The grant could be applied to the preliminary design costs, and so if that grant was approved, if council received that grant, that plus $300,000 from Entercom would cover the $600,000 preliminary design cost. The grant must be used by June of 2019. Our preliminary design schedule is to begin in January of 2019 to do the actual preliminary design tasks from February through May. In June, we would produce that preliminary design report, and that would meet that deadline from the PCA for the reuse grant and also complete the preliminary design work. Overall, this slide shows the overall project schedule, which is tentative. Entercom is going through a lot of decision-making about their project. And they have a lot of moving parts. The reclaimed water service is just one of those moving parts. But we've outlined these timeframes based on when they've said that they can anticipate needing reclaimed water service. And we want to lay out a schedule that lets them know that we are ready to meet their deadline. So this is tentative, but what we anticipate to meet that timeframe. So preliminary design work from January through June of 2019. If this schedule moves ahead in the summer of 2019, we could envision doing the public process for any regional investment. And we would come back to the Environment Committee in the first quarter of 2019 to talk about that process and get the authorization to begin that. We don't want to begin that public process until Entercom has some public process of their own out talking with the public about their project themselves. But some of the feedback that we got in our facility plan public hearing was the public wants to hear from Entercom about their project. Through July through December of 2019, we anticipate doing detailed design. January through April of 2020 would be construction contract bid and award. May through 2020 through October 2021 would be the construction phase. And then commissioning and startup October through December of 2021. This work is consistent with the Thrive MSP 2040 lens. The council's role of pursuing wastewater reuse where economically feasible, as a means to promote sustainable water resources. Working with our partners, we've been meeting and talking with the two communities in particular who are where the project would be located, in Invergrove Heights and Rosemont, maximizing regional benefits from regional investments and providing efficient, high-quality, sustainable wastewater services. The proposed action is that the Metropolitan Council authorize staff to execute a memorandum of understanding and a design deposit agreement for preliminary design with Enerkem related to reclaimed water service. With that, I would be happy to answer any questions or receive any comments, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Deborah. Are there questions or comments for Deborah? Councilmember Lutowski?
Hi, I do have a question. I'm wondering about the timing you talk about. I'm trying to find it here. What slide is it? 9, I think. Slide 9, summer of 2019, the regional investment cost share public process. What is, do you have any anticipated amount that the cost share would be?
We are working on that estimate of that through the criteria that the council set for that. We don't have a number at this time or a value, and would like to have that as part of the discussion with the Environment Committee in the first quarter 2019.
Okay, so the $600,000 cost for the design doesn't have anything to do with this regional cost share?
At this point, let me answer, Madam Chair, let me answer that this way. We would anticipate that any regional cost share would be applied to the cost of the construction and of the facilities and reduce that cost, rather than right now we're looking to have the Enerkem pay the design phase costs directly. That answers the question.
I'm sorry. I feel like I'm being dense. Maybe I just need to see the numbers in a different way. But so I thought we were anticipating that they would pay the cost of the construction.
Yes, they would.
And so where does the regional cost share?
Yeah.
Doesn't that mean that other people are paying for it?
I understand.
Right. The regional cost share, if it's approved by council, would go to reduce the construction costs, but Enerkem would still be paying construction costs for the project, but that regional cost share could be applied to reduce some of those construction costs.
So those aren't a given right now?
The regional cost share?
Or Enerkem.
It's not.
So at this point, there is no agreement about cost share at the construction level?
No, Madam Chair, there is not. At this point, our conversations with Enerkem is that they would pay the full costs unless that regional cost share is approved. And then there would be a reduction to the amount of that regional cost share.
Does that answer your question?
I believe so, and it doesn't.
Councilmember McCarthy.
Just a follow-up question. So if they've already agreed to paying the construction costs, then why are we even possibly looking into, a cost share?
Madam Chair, at this point, part of the reason for doing the design is to define what those construction costs are. So at this point, we don't know for sure exactly what those construction costs are. We've outlined in that memorandum of understanding that Enerkem would pay construction costs. Again, that's a non-binding agreement at this point. Enerkem would pay construction costs that could be reduced if a regional cost share is approved. I hope that clarifies that.
Maybe. Other questions? Councilmember Lutowski?
It does clarify it, but you have in the plan that we're investing in a public process to get to yes on a cost share thing. So it seems like you're sort of expecting that is going to happen.
Madam Chair.
As opposed to saying we're not going to have that conversation with our ratepayers in our communities. We are just going to expect that Enerkem is going to pay for it. So do you understand why it's a little, you know, kind of going around the way about it?
I'll try to say this in a different way. The memorandum of understanding outlines where we think that our mutual understandings about the project. Because we do not know if there is a regional cost share, we have to say in that understanding that those costs would be intercoms if they would be intercoms and could be reduced if the regional cost share is approved. We don't know at this point if that's the case. I listed the public process for that cost share and this schedule in order to kind of give a heads up that we hope to come back to the Environment Committee in the first quarter of 2019 to say, you know, should we go ahead with this public process or when, and provide more information about the amount that we're estimating.
Councilmember Wolf, did you have?
I don't have a question. I mean, it seems clear to me that what we're being asked for today is just the design agreement, design deposit part of it. The conversation about whether there's going to be any cost share hasn't happened yet. So, you know, talking about that conversation would happen in next year, it doesn't mean that there will be a cost share. We don't even know right now what the costs are, and as far as paying for the design, you know, if they want to pay for the design part, even if you're opposed to a cost share, there shouldn't be a problem with paying for the design and having a design agreement. So I guess I'm trying to understand what Councilmember Litovsky's concerns are.
May I, Chair? Sure. I would actually vote yes on this motion because of your very point.
Okay.
Yes. This is about the design costs. I understand that, but they're laying out a scenario in which they are going to ask for cost share. So on the one hand, they're saying that Enerkin is going to do it. I understand that, but even just planning to ask the question, right? If we weren't planning on asking the question, then we would assume that Enerkin is paying for it. Mm-hmm. If we're planning on asking the question and engaging our community, putting resources into that engagement with the community, we're spending resources and staff time to have that conversation about whether or not we should do it. Wouldn't ask it if you didn't want the answer to be yes, right? So I'm just anticipating, I will vote yes on this for sure, for the reasons that you point out, but I don't want to be blind to the idea that there is going to be a request in the future that other people are going to be paying for this. That's all.
Councilmember Wolf.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I never assume when we go out to ask the public about something that we're going to do it. I wait for what feedback comes back before I decide whether we're going to do it. I mean, it's been kind of teed up to ask, but who knows? It could come in way cheap and could be done without anything, or could come out way expensive where it's not going to work. It's just part of the future discussion. It doesn't mean in order to have that discussion, the answer should be yes. We've had discussions where the answer ends up being no, and that's fine.
Right, and up to that point, no shovel has been put in the ground.
Right.
Mark, Councilmember McCarthy.
Madam Chair, maybe I can help you a little bit by asking this question. Where in the memorandum, I'm looking through it, does it talk about the construction cost? I see much language on design, and the only construction that I see that talks about bids maybe is under 1D, but is there anywhere in particular here that we can look at?
Thank you. This is mostly about the design.
I feel like I've made my point anyway, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Councilmember Letofsky. I think you have too. So, there are other questions or concerns? Seeing none, is there a motion to authorize the staff to execute a memorandum of understanding and a design deposit agreement for preliminary design with Enerkem related to reclaimed water services?
Move approval.
We have a motion.
Support.
And a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Deborah, I think you have the next item, 2013-347, the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency Wastewater Reuse Grant Agreement.
Thank you, Madam Chair. MPCA has a wastewater reuse grant program. SKB Environmental, one of the partners of Enerkem in their project, pursued grant funds from the legislature in accordance with that program. The legislature appropriated $300,000 from the Environmental Fund to the MPCA for that wastewater reuse grant. The purpose was for design or construction of wastewater infrastructure for waste to biofuel development. Matching funds would be required of $300,000. Enerkem could provide those matching funds via the design deposit agreement. The funds are available until June 30th, 2019, and the proposal is to use that grant money for the Southeast Metro Water Reclamation Facility preliminary design. It is in accordance with council policy of pursuing non-council funds for wastewater reuse projects. Just ran through this figure, so I'm going to skip that. Again, the design, the preliminary design schedule is shown here, starting in January of 2019, the tasks being done from February through May, and completing the report in June of 2019, within the time frame of the PCA grant availability. This work is in conformance with the Thrive MSP 2040 lens of the council pursuing wastewater reuse where economically feasible as a means to promote sustainable water resources, working with our partners, engaging PCA in this case, maximizing regional benefits from regional investments, and providing efficient, high-quality, sustainable wastewater services. The proposed action is that the Metropolitan Council authorize staff to negotiate and execute a wastewater reuse grant agreement with Minnesota Pollution Control Agency.
Thank you, Deborah. Are there questions for Deborah?
Move approval. Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes. It's one of the times when I'm grateful for the Clean Water Council. Thank you, Deborah. We will now move on to item 2018-348, same week. Security Officer Services Contract, and Mr. White is going to walk us through this.
Okay. Good evening, Madam Chair and Council members. The proposed action is that the Metropolitan Council authorize the Regional Administrator to execute Contract 18P-248. With Securitas Security Services to provide security officer service for Met Council facilities and the 390 North Robert Street building from a time period of February 1, 2019 through end of January 2022 in the amount not to exceed $3,885,000. This contract provides security guard services, as said, at several MCS facilities and the Robert Street building. Licensed contractor must provide professional, trained, and qualified uniformed security officers to perform security services reasonably necessary to protect the council from vandalism, theft, and damage. And the contractor staff has the full responsibility for securing buildings, grounds, and entrances to the council locations to provide a safe and secure working environment. The procurement issued a competitive request for proposal process. 7 proposals were received and evaluated. A 4-person team consisted of staff from regional administration, finance, MCS security, and the panel discussed the merits of the proposals and ranked them based on the value and criteria. Quality of the proposal, qualifications of the proposer, experience of the proposer, their service delivery plan, and the price. The evaluation panel determined it is in the best interest of the council to award to security services, and the cost of the services are reasonable and sustainable for the 3-year contract term. And through the Thrive lens, the effort was to competitively bid the process, which provides the best pricing and service for the council. So again, as a proposed action, we're proposing that the Met Council authorize the regional administrator to execute the contract 18P248 with Securitas Security Services USA Incorporated to provide the security officer services for the Met Council facilities and the 390 North Robert Street building for a time period from February 1, 2019 to January 31, 2022 in the amount not to exceed $3,885,000. Any questions on this proposal?
Questions, Councilmember Wolf.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Is this the same people that we have now or different?
It is the same group that we have now.
Other questions? Councilmember Lutowski.
Thank you, Chair. So, Councilmember Wolf, that was the first question I had, too.
I did, too.
The second question is, do we know the starting pay, kind of per hour, for the security guards?
I do not have that. They are all, basically all the ones that applied are at a union rate. So they're pretty much the starting pay is all the same for that group. And then it varies, you know, how they work from that, their rates from that. I can get that information to you if you'd like.
I would like it. That would be great. But also you mentioned that they're union and that was my other question. So I appreciate that too. Well, I imagine they got a pretty good deal then.
Councilmember Vernosa.
Thank you. Just a point of clarification, they're paid at the union rate or they're union workers? Mm. There is a difference.
So I have a couple people that were on the committee here. If you don't mind, I'll ask one of them. Do you know that, Steve?
Should I come up or
come up? This is Steve Eppel. He is our security expert here at Met Council.
So these are all the incumbents, and they're all paid at the union rate. Some of them might actually be making more, but none are making less, is my understanding. And the proposal had a bill rate and a markup rate. And as I remember it, the bill rate was, the markup rate was competitive, and most of it's going to be, these people are going to be making a little bit more than what they would be making if they weren't the incumbents, because they're already here with us. So they're going to be getting some pay raises.
Great.
And that's a part of the retention
program. Yeah, so right.
To be able to, for them, one of the things that they looked at when they evaluated was their ability to retain staff. So that's why some of them will be, you know, paying a little bit higher than what they, maybe the minimum rate that they could pay.
Councilmember Reynoso.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So I guess the question is, you know, and Councilmember Lutowski kind of started to ask pay-wise what we're looking at. I think it's important that, you know, that they employ livable wages, livable wages, should I say. So it would be great to know what that scale would be. I know there's some very inexpensive security programs that are out there and pay especially. So I just want to know that we're paying fair wages. Right. And again, are they union? Are they non-union? Because there's a difference between paying union scale and them being union members.
It is all union. Okay. And there's 2 bargaining agreements. One is for the city of St. Paul and one is for the suburbs.
Okay.
So the security officers that are in this building are paid a little bit more with the city of St. Paul bargaining agreement, and the officers that are in the Metro plant and in Shakopee, Farmington, and Eagan are possibly making a little bit less with the bargaining agreement.
Okay.
But then again, the business side of it, some of these officers may have been with Securitas for X amount of 15 years. Maybe individually they've been making pay raises along the way. So I can't speak to all their, they're not all exactly paid the same, but they are paid with the union rates. No less than the union rates. I think they're all making more, right?
Okay.
And Madam Chair, that's part of, you know, I mean, obviously we could have went out for just a pure low price, but that doesn't give us the best quality and service and, you know, fair pay if we do that. And, but I think even then, if I understand right, most of the firms that are large enough to handle this are all now on that union rate.
Yes.
So it would be difficult for somebody non-union to bid on this project and be successful, you know, meeting all the requirements.
Thank you. That's good to know.
Thank you.
Yeah. Other questions? So we have a motion here to execute the contract. We don't have a motion. Could I have a motion?
I'll move it.
We second. Have a motion.
Gotta get it in there.
Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes.
Okay.
Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Item 2018-349, same week, is a business analytics professional services contract. And is it, oh my goodness, we have a team coming up here. So do I start with Larry?
Yes, ma'am.
You've got the floor.
So Madam Chair, committee members, good afternoon. Thank you. We are here to present business item 2018-349, Business Analytics Professional Services Contract Amendment. This business item addresses a current contract that we have with Dunn Solutions Group, who have been helping environmental services develop and implement the customer service portal that you heard about as an information item, I believe, back in October. At that time, we were unable to demo the system and wanted to take this opportunity to share program highlights. So many council staff have participated in the development of the product. Joining me are Anna Bessel, who led the customer focus team, and Ricky Arora, whose department, in partnership with our information services group, and Dunn Solutions, developed all the technical and business process automation. So we'd like to start with Ricky and Anna doing the demo that you never got to see last night.
I was going to say, these are familiar faces, aren't they? So please proceed.
So I'm Ricky Arora, and I'm the Manager of Performance Excellence and Analytics. And my department provides performance solutions like job aids and root cause analysis and business analytics, MCS-wide. The portal that you're going to see is basically online self-service portal for MCS communities to provide access to up-to-date and readily available information about flow data, system response to wet weather events, and online submissions of work plans, credits, and appeals, and means of electronic communications with social networking features like message boards to collaborate and inform communities with any kind of announcements that MCS has. So it's going to be a two-way collaboration between the communities. With that, I'll hand over to Anna, at least to start the portal demo.
Okay. Thank you, Ricky. I'm Anna Bessel of Engineering Programs, and my work group has a high level of customer interaction through administration of the inflow and infiltration program and also the municipal wastewater charge. I'm also the team manager of the ES Customer Service Working Group. And the data portal that I'm about to demo for you was developed to support one of the group's initiatives, which was to improve online access to MCES information. So without further ado, I'd like to show you the portal. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I already have an account, so I'm gonna go ahead and sign in.
It happened to be earlier today.
It's a user. All right, and as you may recall, this uses a two-factor authentication. So when I click submit on my username and password, I do receive a PIN on my mobile device. So I'm going to enter that now. Okay, but let's say that you didn't have an account and you are a new user. Just by entering a few pieces of simple information, such as your address and your title at the city, and also the communities that you'd like to request, you can request an account. The request will go to MCS staff, and they will approve the account and also assign any communities that you'd like. So in the case of a consultant that may do work for more than one community, they may want access to several. So now going back here, I'd like to provide a brief overview of the main page. And you can see at the top, I've been assigned to the community of Maplewood. This is where other communities would show up if they were assigned to you. And if I were to make another selection here, it would change this page and customize it to that other community. There are two main dashboards when you log in. The first being total community flow on the left. On the right, you see all of the meter sheds that are located within the city of Maplewood. And just for anybody that doesn't know, a meter shed is a meter service area. You scroll down, you can see a map of the community that shows those meter sheds along with any MCES facilities. Those diagonal lines that you see in some areas designate areas of unmetered flow, which means that they do not flow through an MCES billing meter. You can right click on this map, save the image, or print it. This area on the right here contains outreach items. So MCS staff can choose to upload items related to event announcements, educational tools, grant information, really anything that they want our users to know about. And as we scroll to the bottom, we see recent documents. It provides users with quick access to any reports or other documentation that MCS staff has generated for them. So now I'd like to get back to those dashboards at the top of the page. These are invaluable for communities who are often interested in flow data for setting their budget and for planning system upgrades. Now the display default is monthly data, which may be useful in determining if the community flows have increased from previous years. You can use these radio buttons to view either a trend or a year-over-year comparison. An increase or a decrease in community flow is one factor that may clue a community in to a change in their municipal wastewater charge. So this is very helpful in determining if maybe you need to include a little more money in your budget. Now we have been looking at monthly data, but you can also view daily data. You can choose to update the dates using the calendars on the right-hand side of the page, left-hand side of the page. And the system really allows users to customize the plots. You can choose to add additional meter sheds. Here's the plot on the right. And this allows users to compare changes in flow from different areas of the community and may provide insights into which areas are most susceptible to inflow and infiltration. It can also indicate the effectiveness in INI work in certain meter service areas and can help indicate issues with system operations. Let's say a community is trying to track down a major water leak and they're concerned that water is entering the sanitary sewer system. They can use this meter shed daily plot to pinpoint where the leak may have occurred and whether or not water is entering the system. And one other thing I'd like to point out is that communities can choose to print these plots. Now that will generate a PDF that includes a whole suite of different plots that include different combinations of meter sheds and also daily and monthly data. So another major feature of this portal is the ability to download data. Currently, communities must contact somebody at MCES to request the data. They must also fill out a data disclaimer form, sign it, and return it to us. Once we receive the request, it can take anywhere from 1 to 5 days to turn the data around. It really depends on workload and also if there's any questions surrounding the data that may require further investigation. So with the download data function, communities can choose to download 3 different data types on demand. Those are daily, monthly,
and peak flows. They can also request hourly or 15-minute data, which is raw data. So that doesn't receive the same level of QA/QC as the other three types. So let's say that we have a community that has seen INI in the past and it rained yesterday, and they would like to know if the INI has impacted their system. Maybe they've done some work, right? So by looking at the daily plots on the first page, they may have gotten the idea that their flows maybe went up a bit, but they really want to see what the impact is, see what those maximum peak flow rates are, and also whether the peaks were sustained. So here's an example of where you may want to look at 15-minute data. So I'm going to just choose some dates from this drop-down calendar here. I'm going to pick a couple days before and after my supposed storm event. You can choose your file type. I'd like an Excel file. You can enter a reason for your request if you maybe like some feedback from MCS staff. We don't have to do that. And then instead of filling out the disclaimer form, they can simply check a box. Now when I click submit request, we do get a pop-up that says I'll be notified by email when my data is available. What happens is the system will pull the request and send an email to MCS staff. So the request is ready to review. So all the staff member needs to do is open the email, take a look at the data, and if it looks good, you can click a button and off zips the data to the user. So let's say that I got my email on my phone that says my data request is complete. I can log into my account, go into the documents section. There's a folder for approved requests. And here I can view my file and download the data. Mm-hmm. And there it is. So I just want to briefly point out a few other features that the portal has to offer. Communities can also use the portal to submit INI work plans right here in the work plan tab and apply for credits as INI work is completed. This is an easy way to track the INI work and keep a record of past expenses. There are also features for communicating with MCS staff, including the message board and the contact tab on this page. Similar, but it's just a matter of user preference. And now I would like to hand it back off to Ricky, who'd like to talk about a few other benefits of the web portal.
So the portal features provide following business benefits. It provides up-to-date and readily available information to communities about flow data, system response to wet weather events, reported INI mitigation work and appeals. It also, communities use this information to make informed decisions about INI mitigation activities for public education, and to help garner support for investments that help protect the sustainability of the municipal wastewater collection systems, and also increase customer satisfaction, increased customer confidence in data accuracy, reduced errors, reduced customer complaints, and increased productivity due to automation of several internal business processes. We'd like to open up for any further questions on the demo, please, now.
Councilmember McCarthy.
Madam Chair, when the community makes a request, do they have to put between what periods they would like to be able to download that information?
That would be correct. So in the download data request option, you saw there was a start date and an end date. So they can pick, their time frame or time period and their file format. And that's once the request is reviewed and approved and uploaded, they will get a further notification saying, go and take a look at the portal under documents, and that's where their data will be available for the time period that they requested.
Councilmember McCarthy.
And how will the community, what have you done to let the community know this is available and train them on it?
Great question, ma'am. So this is a work in progress. It's still on the test system. Last time it didn't work because it was on the sandbox, so we have made progress to put it in different stages of development. Our plan is to make sure that this goes into the pre-production mode first, where we do get some community's feedback on this portal. And then we will make adjustments to it before it can go in production. So it's still work in progress. It's on the test system, and it's work in progress.
Great. Thank you. So now we're going to move on in the presentation about other information.
Very good. So now we'll go back to our business item.
Yes.
Which is related to the demo. Okay. Okay, maybe not. Thank you. All right, so background first. Dunn Solutions is an integral partner in designing and developing the INI portal that you just saw. We are midway through a 4-year contract with Dunn to deliver business analytics tools and visualizations. There are multiple projects in the contract scope, but we chose to prioritize the portal for implementation in order to meet the MCES strategic goal of providing better customer service. Well, as the project plan for this portal was developed, we had a better understanding of the requirements, which then evolved to include the demand on-demand data access, the improved workflows, automating some of our business processes, and as a result, the project was more extensive and more complex than we originally anticipated. So we're in the middle of this contract with Dunn. The contract expires December 2020. To date, we have expended most of the original $544,500 contract value, which paid for developing the portal, but also we retired a water quality database that had duplicate information. We upgraded our SCADA and our laboratory information system database sets. We enhanced our SCADA cybersecurity. We enhanced our industrial waste reporting and analytics of their data, and upgraded our reporting and analytics for our work and asset management systems. However, work still remains to be done in developing new visualization tools and performance metrics, training and mentoring of our staff, ongoing support and deployment of the portal, as well as developing new use cases that are currently being requested by our customers. They saw this and they would like more. So in order to continue developing those tools, the current contract with Dunn needs to be amended to include an additional $560,000 of funding. So the action advances the Thrive outcomes of stewardship, sustainability, and prosperity, and the Thrive principles of integration, collaboration, and accountability. So the proposed action is that the Metropolitan Council authorize its regional administrator to amend contract 16P239 with Dunn Solutions Group to add $560,000 with a not to exceed amount of $1,104,500 for a contract period ending December 31st, 2020. So open up for any questions.
Thank you very much. Questions, council members?
Move approval, Madam Chair.
Okay, we have a motion.
Second.
Any other comments or discussion? I have a question. Have you done any analysis of the not only improved customer service, but the savings to staff time and accuracy? Is there any way you can project that?
We have automated several business processes because all of the data is scattered in different databases. So when you saw that demo, you know, where it brings that hourly numbers, it's assembling it automatically behind the scenes. So that's the kind of savings or staff savings where it doesn't have to go through multiple staff in multiple departments. So the data assembly itself is automated, and all staff needs to do now, for example, is just QA and QC the data and make sure that they click a button that uploads the file. So those are one of the examples of, you know, where we have seen staff time savings and then improvement and streamline in business process as well.
Seems to me it would be highly effective in terms of saving staff time and in terms of increased accuracy, because everybody's getting the same data at the same time. So those alone are worth the investment. Any other comments or questions? And that doesn't surprise me that the customers want more.
Exactly. Yeah. They've been asking for this for a long time.
They have. So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you all very much. Congratulations on getting it working. It's good to see. Yes.
It's really cool to see.
Good to see.
Thank you, Madam Chair and Council members.
Thank you very much.
The next item on the agenda is the information item we have. Larry, you're going to be talking to us still some more on continuous improvement.
I am back. So, Madam Chair, Environment Committee members, I have the pleasure of introducing Christine Levitt and today's info item presentation. Our continuous improvement program has come out of our desire to better meet the needs of our customers, as you just saw, and develop a high performance work culture within ES. We'd like to start with a brief background of our improvement journey and then introduce Project Spotlights, where we will spend most of our time this afternoon. MCES started out small, focusing on a few improvement projects and staff training. In 2015, we launched 6 continuous improvement projects to evaluate the business value of this tool and potential use within environmental services. By this year, by now, that number has grown that we launched 20 new projects in 2016. We currently have Six Sigma black belts on staff and 11 green belts on staff. And these levels represent different levels of competencies of training and proficiency in the principles, methods, and tools of continuous improvement. In 2015, Christine Levitt joined MCES first as a consultant from the Minnesota Department of Admin Office of Continuous Improvement. And in 2016, she was hired to fill a new position as the ES Manager of Continuous Improvement. So at this point, I'll turn over the presentation to Christine.
And before Christine begins, could you explain to me what a Kaizen event is?
I'd be delighted, Madam Chair and members of the committee. A Kaizen event is a process improvement project. And in fact, the Ricky and Anna, who you heard from earlier, the kind of initial kickoff for some of what was discovered or identified to build that portal tool came out of a Kaizen event. And in a Kaizen event, what we do is we bring a cross-functional team together of people who understand the work. We map out the process, and then we work with the team to say, where is the process not working well for our customers and our staff? And then we basically identify what we call those pain points. And then we brainstorm. Sometimes we end up doing some root cause analysis to get to why those pain points exist in the first place. And then we brainstorm improvement ideas, and the team comes to consensus around a future state process. They map that process, and then they put together an action plan to implement those changes to get to that future state process. So in the I&I project you heard about, one of those improvement efforts was to create the portal. And so it was really fun for me to hear and see, along with yourselves, what great work is coming out of that initial effort or event, Kaizen event.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So at this juncture, I'll kind of move us in our presentation. So just a little bit of background. Larry thought it might be helpful for you for me to just share a little bit about my background. I've got a background in economics and organizational development, which is really about helping leaders and the people that work in organizations basically improve performance. I've been in the public sector for about 30 years. Over that 30 years, I've worked with or for about 20 different public sector entities. Not that I've changed jobs that much, but that when I was working for the Department of Administration, I was able to work with almost all cabinet level organizations in the state, which was a great opportunity to really kind of embed this knowledge and have that
help people basically improve their services for their customers. And so I've done about over 100 different continuous improvement projects at this juncture, and trained about 2,000 people in basically the methods and tools and principles of continuous improvement. Here you see listed just a variety of the different approaches. Continuous improvement is really this ongoing effort to improve our products, our services, our processes, and the workspaces. And in many cases, using kind of best practices. Part of my training is in both as a Baldrige evaluator and also in Lean and Six Sigma, which are process improvement techniques, not karate types of, although I wish I knew karate. I'm sure it'd be really fun for me. But so I always talk about continuous improvement having three key components. It's a mindset where we have a series of principles that we're striving to put into place, first being customer service. And I'm not going to go through the long list, but it's also a methodology. And it's a structured methodology where we understand what's going on in our current state. And then we put in place some kind of intervention or solution. We study how well it works, and then we make adjustments. So it's a scientific method, basically. And then it's a set of best practice tools that we use. So that gives you a little bit about continuous improvement. And I already described a little bit of the process or methodology already. This is the Lean methodology that was developed by D. Edward Stemming, which might ring a bell. And it's really based on the scientific method. That's the cornerstone of this work. And so I'm not going to go into any other details than other than saying it's an iterative process and it builds in learning. What I like to tell teams, instead of doing plan and do, we actually kind of take it to the next step after we implement. And we say, hey, that change we made, did it achieve the results we had hoped? And if not, what do we need to do differently? And then we start the process over again. And so that's a core part of this. And I just wanted to emphasize that piece of it for you today. The next thing I'd like to touch on is just one of the main reasons we also wanted to just tell you a little bit about these project spotlights. You may recall this past summer in August, I believe, you had an opportunity to hear from the different interns and urban scholars. Mm-hmm. I have the pleasure of having two of those young professionals who were before your group. So you may recall some of the project spotlights. But I have, anyway, so we're going to be kind of talking a little bit about those. And so this tool, or these project spotlights, were really possible because I had that additional support to help us document some of the great work the council, and specifically environmental services, has been doing to improve our services for our customers and for the people doing the work. So here's a few examples. I'm going to have Larry just show you how we sometimes share this. I have been sharing some of the information about these projects in different settings. The river data collection and reporting project was a Kaizen event. I've already kind of described what that process is for a Kaizen event, but this is, you know, just to give a little bit of background. The purpose of this particular project was basically to look at how do we streamline the process and make it more effective and standardize it for how data is collected and reported for our river data collection program. And so through that process, we brought, again, this cross-functional team. You can see the team members. They're a little bit small, but it was a pretty good-sized team. We bring them together and we mapped out the process, noted the kind of opportunities for improvement, and then came up with a future state process. I'm pleased to share that at this particular juncture, that particular process reduced the process time from 353 days to 51 days for getting those reports out. In addition, it reduced the data transfer errors from 80,000 per month to zero. And a lot of that had to do with implementing a mobile collection tool that I'll be describing in the next spotlight. It also, they reduced the time for loading data sheet information into the LIM system, from which is a data collection system that they use, from 12 months to 5 months. So you get so these spotlights are prepared at the conclusion of a project, after we do a lessons learned with the team, and we say, how did this work from start to finish and to what we call the kind of sustainment phase or control phase of the project. After that, we prepare one of these project spotlights, and it's really a great opportunity for both acknowledging the team and the work that they did, but also motivating other people to take on projects and kind of spurring this culture of improvement. So the mobile computing monitoring tool that was developed was really a byproduct of that river data collection and reporting Kaizen event. And similar to the portal that you just heard about, this was a tool that was used to basically help folks in the field who were recording data on information sheets, basically pieces of paper. So this particular project really focused on taking a kind of a manual paper-based process that had a lot of opportunities for errors, and using a tool to basically eliminate those errors, and at the same time make data almost instantly available. And so a lot of work goes into the kind of execution phase of a project, and this is one of those tools that really had a profound impact on making data both more readily available, more quickly available, and also better quality data. The next project I'd like to highlight is the lab services communication workout. So like the Kaizen event I described, a workout is another type of improvement project. And what's cool about the workout, sometimes I say a workout is the first step in becoming lean, using the lean reference as a process improvement methodology. But with the workout, it's really a great management tool. They bring their team, usually a functional group of folks together, and they basically ask them about the work they do, what gets in their way, and what ideas do they have for how that work can be better. And then there's a list of kind of a prioritized list of recommendations that are provided to the manager, and the manager then puts together recommendations on those changes that they're going to move forward. So in this particular project, it was really focused on internal communication. How can we improve internal communication for lab services employees? And so coming out of that, group developed and implemented a whiteboard that they use for posting current information for people to easily ask questions. We call it a visual management tool. So if there was a new hire, they would post that information. If there were some issues people were finding, they would then record that. Any new changes in the process, they'd also document in that location. So it's just one of the tools that they use to enhance communication. They also instituted weekly meetings, so folks knew kind of what was coming up that week and could better prepare and respond to changes in kind of their process and what was coming through the door in terms of sampling, and also their work schedule. One of the particular results I'd like to highlight from the lab service communication workout was that through the changes that they implemented, they experienced a 23% increase in what they call the maintain demonstration of capability tests. What this really allowed them to do is each employees go through a set of training so they can show proficiency in how they do the sampling process. And Lisa, you can correct me if I have this confused, but through this effort, they were able to train and build kind of the flexibility and resilience of their workforce, and using these communication tools helped them achieve that improved bench strength of their workforce. The next project I'd like to highlight, and don't worry, I won't go in, there's been 10 to date, and we'll just have one more after this. is a total residuals chlorine testing project. And this was what was interesting, and what I'm going to highlight about this project, the testing is actually done on site in the plants. And one of the key aspects of process improvement work is what we call going and seeing how the work is done. And so there was a lot of sometimes assumptions that we make. So in lab services, where they have this very, you know, really nice state-of-the-art lab equipment and materials, we don't have that in our plants. And so one of the key things that helped them overcome some hurdles and really understand some of the challenges in making sure people were doing the sampling protocol correctly in the different plants was seeing how they perform the work and what access to resources they had to get that work done. And so that was kind of an aha moment I heard from some of the people who were involved in this team. And through that kind of growing awareness, they came together and developed some really great ways of training and certifying all these plant operators in how to correctly and accurately execute the monitoring protocol to get accurate results for their total chlorine testing. So the next and last spotlight I'd like to highlight for you is also a unique one. So the support services business unit, over the past year, but this project has been kind of a bit ongoing for a few years, they developed what we call strategy maps. So in the nature of the work we do, having clarity around the purpose, the priorities, and what success looks like for the work we do is really important. So that's kind of foundational. And with that firm and solid foundation, employees can really better make decisions. Leaders can better make decisions on, will this change help us basically get to our vision of success? And so Larry's business unit did a strategy map. You'll see it kind of in that lower right-hand corner of the spotlight. And in that experience, he found it of value and suggested that we have each of the departments do a strategy map for their own department. And through that process, it was very collaborative. All staff were involved in those projects. And at this juncture, all seven departments do have strategy maps. As part of that process with the team, the visions that came out of those were built with the input of their employees. And we also did surveys at the conclusion of those different strategy maps and had great feedback from the teams. They felt that they had more clarity on the purpose of their work and how their work aligns with and supports both their department and the larger division work and the council's work. So I have my contact information here. If any of the committee members are interested in learning more about continuous improvement, some of the methods and tools that we have available, I'd be delighted to chat with you about what we're doing. And I know I kind of went through a lot of this pretty quickly. So if you have any questions, we'd be happy to take those.
Excellent, Christine. Questions, comments? Well, I can say it's what a high note to end the year on. I was reading all the data that you had on various projects and the efficiencies and stuff. And I was just amazed, you know, that how much can be done when you really think through a way to do it systematically. I was just amazed at how much you are doing. And you started with just a few projects, and now you're up to how many?
We've done over 20 this year.
And over the 5 years you've done?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, I'm just going to correct that while we launch 20 projects, they don't all get finished within a year. Mm-hmm. So of those 20 projects we've listed, I think it does, I know it's somewhere in here, this pile of papers. We've probably completed about 13 of those projects. Mm-hmm. And so there's kind of a rolling kind of time frame where we start a project, we get some of them done that year and some of them rolled into the next year. Mm-hmm. The inflow and infiltration project you heard about, that's probably on its second year. We'll look forward to doing a project spotlight and hopefully sharing that with the committee at a future juncture.
Yeah, this is the sheet I was thinking of.
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah, I was just, and what's this green belt and black belt, or somebody got a black belt somewhere.
So I have a black belt, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Basically, green belts and black belts are, you're trained in a standardized approach for how you improve performance. And so we currently have green belts going through a program. It's basically over the course of 5 months. Mm-hmm. They have an improvement project. So we get work done at the same time while they're building their skills. And they meet for 9 days where they go through the methodologies and the tools of continuous improvement. Primarily Lean and Six Sigma are what they're reviewing. Mm-hmm. It's a very collaborative approach that really relies on the leaders or project sponsors to set the outcome for or results that they'd like that team to achieve. And then we rely on the competent, creative, high-performing employees that do the work each day to figure out how to get it. And to me, that's what's inspiring about the work.
Can you comment on, I've got to imagine, there's been a change in morale or sense of purpose or what are you seeing?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, there's a continuous improvement index that the Department of Admin launches, and they collect information like this for all state agencies and cabinet level agencies, including the council. I think that typically, and we also do a survey at the conclusion of most of the projects, people do feel that the process honors the work they do, and they feel that they have an opportunity to make it better for themselves and their customers. And so I think that it's a great asset and opportunity for this organization to grow our capability. And I think it's well received.
Councilmember Wolf.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Are they doing this in any other council divisions, or is this only ES work?
Madam Chair, Councilmember
Wolf.
Wolf. Thank you for that question. To date, I'm the only continuous improvement manager in the council, and I do reside in Environmental Services Division. At the same time, I will tell you I've done a Kaizen event for our human resource process, our hiring process, and I've done a workout with the communication group. I do feel that they see the value of some of these tools and resources. I know that they were trying to fill a position. I'm only supportive and believe that this work could be better done if we had more people who could also speak to the method. And sometimes there's a little terminology hurdle. I do call it process improvement now instead of Kaizen events, but we can get beyond language.
Councilmember McCarthy.
Madam Chair, I've been very proud of the effectiveness and the knowledge and educational level of this department to begin with. And so, but now having heard this, I even have a better understanding of why we are this way and how fundamental this is in the success of ES.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for this presentation.
Excellent leadership right here. And we're bringing on the right people to do the job. So I really appreciate what you're doing, Larry. And
Madam Chair, if I can jump in here, it takes everybody. I mean, that's what ES is really, I think, thriving on, is that we're trying to live that we're better together. Christine talked about all these efforts being cross-functional teams. And that's really what's making the difference, because mm-hmm. we get all those perspectives together. You can't help but figure out a better sense of things. So, and she helped us bring process to it, because when you get a bunch of people together, You've got to have some order to it, right?
Well, thank you. What a wonderful way to end the year. And thank you for your presentation.
And I'm just going to cast one more highlight on that. So Christine mentioned she worked previously at the Office of Continuous Improvement at the state. And I can't take any credit for orchestrating the timing on this, but the Governor's Better Government Awards is actually this week, and we are a finalist in the workforce planning category. So we had two cross-functional teams, that one that improved our employee recognition program and basically did a whole overhaul of it. And we also have a diversity outreach program that's very different from anything we've done in the past, that's having really good success. So, you know, we're keeping our fingers crossed. We're going to find out on Thursday if we get to be a winner.
Well, thank you.
Good luck.
Good news. Do you have anything else in your report?
That's it, other than the year is wrapping up so fast, I can hardly believe it.
On a high note. Thank you again.
Our last meeting this
year. Anything else from the committee for the good of the whole? If not, I think we can adjourn this meeting.